Christopher Adkins joins us by Skype. And it's so good. It's so good to see you. And thank you so much. Thank you so much for speaking out, because I know that this does come with risk, especially, you know, as well respected as you are and your wife and your professions, that it does. There is risk associated with speaking so plainly about the truth. So thank you for doing so.
Oh, it's my pleasure. It's an honor to be here. And Dana, I really did enjoy your piece on the canceling of Beethoven the other just
a few
days ago.
Oh my goodness, yes. I just never would have thought that this is where we would ever be, that Beethoven is considered exclusionary and discriminatory. And you know, the statement that you sent me from about how it's even apparently exclusionary and racist from the League of American Orchestras to even so much as they've prevented people from listening to the symphony, I'm not surprised that it would be in support of this, but to this extent, tell me about your experience with this, and you decided to write a letter to the CEO of the symphony.
Well, the extent, I mean, as you say, we're prevented, according to the League of American Orchestras, we're preventing, actively excluding Black people from, let me read you this laundry list that they give us. We're preventing them from auditioning, from creating, from performing, managing, governing, and even listening to orchestral music. And that's just a progression that goes from the surreal to the totally insane.
Yeah, I have never heard, I'm sure that if that had actually happened, there would have been a news story, and I have not found any news stories of anyone being prevented from listening to anything. You have not partaken in such exclusionary activity.
Well, if I had, I would actually be criminally liable under U.S. law. So,
right.
So no, not one of these things. I have been in the orchestral business for over 45 years. I've been a member of professional orchestras at least a dozen, maybe closer to 20. I lose count. I have never seen one of these charges, a single incident of any of them, ever occur a single time.
And the letter that you wrote, I thought was very poignant. And there was at one point you take issue with the indictment of you yourself being included. You write, and this is, he's writing this to the CEO of the symphony. I'm pulling this quote up. He says, if the phrase all of us doesn't include Kim Noldemy and Christopher Adkins, then it doesn't actually possess any discernible meaning at all. So the assertion is, quote, systemic racism and discrimination are rooted in a belief system, white supremacy, into which, you know, obviously you and Mr. Noldemy were born. Well, no, Christopher Adkins was most assuredly not born into the belief system of white supremacy. And I would be relatively comfortable in the surmise that young Kim was also led in a different direction, end quote, because that's what it is. You're being told that you have to accept a falsehood, that you are somehow, you possess a moral failing to this egregious nature. And that's, I mean, you're being told to confess to something awful that you have not done.
That's one of the really unfair things about it. But of course, it extends beyond the personal that, you know, that I have listened to more auditions, for instance, than anyone else in the symphony. I've been on more audition committees. At this point, I've probably heard 10,000 separate individual auditions over the course of my career with the symphony. And for them to say that somehow these people are being excluded, that Black people are being systematically excluded from our auditions. Our auditions happen completely blindly. We never see a picture. We never see the auditioner in person. These things can't even possibly happen. And so it's really just completely absurd, but it really impugns the integrity of me and of every other member of the audition committees for as far back as you care to go.
Right. And as well as the audience as well, for supporting by viewing and giving patronage to and going to every performance. What was this in response to? I mean, were they accused of something before, or do you think that the league just decided, well, we're going to go ahead and get ahead of something, and so let's go ahead and release a statement now to Virtue Signal?
Well, I think it absolutely is a virtue signal, and I think a morally corrosive one. It's really so over the top that it's just like they're standing up shouting, you know, look at me, I'm so virtuous to to get, as you say, get out in front of this. And aside from the personal guilt that it assigns to me, it's really corrosive in other ways, because it delegitimizes the basic mission of American symphony orchestras, which, to state the obvious, is basically to play classical orchestral music. We have immense talent on stage, but if you want the best in African drumming, the DSO is not the place you would think to look. And so our mission is very particular and very narrow, and we've accomplished that well, but that is now declared to be an illegitimate purpose, and the institution must be reoriented to the goal of curing society's ills rather than playing the best music that we know at the highest levels of excellence.
You bring up something very interesting, because that's what so much of the critical race theory is saying needs to happen, is that things need to be restructured because they are unfair as they are. Do you anticipate, is this the first sort of attempt here to perhaps do that with the symphony, with, as you said, with orchestral music? Is this an attempt to restructure even what that is in culture?
Oh, I think it definitely is. And it's happening in Dallas. For instance, at the end, there's a famous series of concerts in London every summer called the Proms at Royal Albert Hall. If you remember your Beatles, you you know how many holes it takes to fill Albert Hall. Well, that's an actual concert hall in London. And there's a famous concert series there. And they have traditionally finished with singing of Rule Britannia. And so this year, they at least played the music, but they didn't allow the singing of the words, which contains a line about Britons shall never be slaves. And so, of course, the argument is that by saying that Britons shall never be slaves, that means it's okay to enslave everybody else. This is the kind of insanity that passes for profound thinking on today's left.
Wow. Oh, and to that, and related to that, one of the, and you mentioned this as well, and this is really ultimately what kickstarted all of this. In the email, and we're talking with Christopher Adkins, who's the principal cellist with the Dallas Symphony Orchestra. He, when Christopher wrote, for the listeners out there and those watching on Pluto, when he emailed, he said that the symphony had traditionally opened each classical concert subscription season with the national anthem. And this year, after rehearsing the anthem at the September 10th morning dress rehearsal, it was cut from the program by the time the evening concert rolled around. And another, and he added, another entertainment industry bowing to pressure from the woke left. Did they ever give you a reason as to why they chose to not play the anthem, or what was the conversation about that?
I actually tried to follow up, and initially I was rebuffed and told that they couldn't say. But Kim, she's a wonderful woman, our CEO, just sent me an email this morning saying that they were told that many members of the orchestra were intending to kneel or sit during the anthem, and they didn't want to become a political centerpiece in the discussion. Well, I'm sorry, by aligning yourself with the woke left, you have made yourself a political centerpiece in the discussion. And there it is.
I mean, taking a knee, I would imagine that by having this statement from the league, and then of course the Dallas Symphony Orchestra supporting this, and then with now not even playing the anthem, is the biggest knee of them all.
It's a complete surrender.
Oh my. How does this make you feel in something, a discipline to which you have given your entire life? And, you know, obviously just adds so, just brings so much joy to so many people. And I'm always in awe of the abilities of people like yourself and those who can play instruments and can put pieces together the way you do. I mean, it really is magical. How, because now we're talking about undermining a great institution, an artistic institution. And it's ironic because it is these artistic institutions that have always been the most open and the most inclusionary and the ones that have ushered forth, you know, enlightenment and everything else. And now it's like they are, for the lack of a better way to put it, the petty Puritans who are trying to shut down any diverse thought or even so much as any question of anything. And they're doing it with something that you love so much and have given so much of your life to.
In answer to your question, in a word, heartbroken. I'm heartbroken that I have devoted my life to the Dallas Symphony. I'm a Texas boy for generations back. I was I was born in Brownwood, Texas. You know, my family's from Ballinger, Texas, which is the little town outside the big town of Brownwood. And the Dallas Symphony has been my hometown orchestra for as long as I can remember. And when I actually came back from my stint in Milwaukee and Denver Symphonies to take the principal chair in Dallas, it was a dream come true. And to see what is in the early stages of happening with the politicization of classical music, it really is heartbreaking.
Wow. Last quick question for you. We're getting short on time and about to wrap up our show. What happens next?
Well, I have no illusions that we can hold up our hands and stop the tide completely, but I hope more and more people will be willing to speak up for the obvious truth that your fellow citizens are not cauldrons of seething hatred. Your fellow citizens are good-hearted people. We all want what's best for everyone. And the things that are being peddled are lies, and they're destructive lies. There's bodies piling up in Chicago and everywhere else from these lies.
Oh, it's just awful. Oh, goodness. Well, we're going to please stay in touch with us and let us know how things unfold. And I hate hearing this, but that this is happening, even like we were discussing, to now it's really affecting every single aspect of art. There's not any aspect of American life that is unaffected by this. Christopher Adkins, thank you so much for being so brave in speaking out about this, and not just in sending a letter to, you know, the CEO, but also coming about it on air with us and talking about it with us, because there are so many people who are unaware, but I know would entirely support you in your effort in this. So thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
Of course. Have a great weekend. God bless.